Hello students, this is our second lesson. Before we begin our second lesson, let us find the answer of the question that I asked you in the first lesson. That is, how many pollens will be formed if each sporangium has 1,000 pollen mother cell? So, as you know, pollen mother cell produces 4 pollens. So, if there are 1,000 of them, then there are going to be 4,000 pollens, right? But then, how many pollen mother cells are there in the entire anther? 1,000 pollen mother cells in one sporangium, and in total, there are 4 theca. So, therefore, 4,000, that is this number, is multiplied by 4 for 4 theca, and the number that you get is 16,000. So, you are going to get 16,000 pollens if each sporangium has 1,000 pollen mother cells. Such questions are very often asked in 1 marker or 2 marker, where you have to be careful as to what cell number is given to you. Is it the number of anthers, or is it the number of sporangia, or is it the number of theca? So you have to calculate accordingly. So now let us learn about a very important term, gametophyte. If you recall from your class 11, gametophyte and sporophyte, these are the two forms in which lower plants are seen. So gametophyte is gamete bearing and sporophyte is spore bearing. If you recall, gametophyte is haploid in nature, sporophyte is diploid in nature. So in case of angiosperm, which is the highest or the most evolved plant form, the gametophyte is represented by a very small structure which is short-lived. This gametophyte or gamete-bearing part of the plant is, in males, the pollen is the gametophyte which bears the male gamete. The male gametes, if you recall from the previous class, are the 2 small cells present inside the pollen grain. So, the pollen is not a male gamete but is a male gametophyte. In case of female, the female gamete is the egg cell which is born inside the ovule. So in case of female, the ovule is the gametophyte. So let us understand the structure of the pistil. Pistil consists of stigma, style and ovary. You can see here in the diagram that the ovary may have 1 ovule or it may have many ovules. Many ovules will be attached to the ovary in variety of ways. We have learnt about this in class 11. So right now we are going to understand what happens inside the ovule. In the second part of this diagram, you can see that how there are various kinds of ovule in angiospermic flower. So these ovules are named according to their position, the way they are located. So in our textbook, we are going to talk about the anatropous ovule, that is the diagram P. This is the diagram which is seen in the textbook. Now, if we focus on the structure of the ovule, we will find that funicle is the part by which it is attached to the ovary, which is then followed by the ovule itself. You can find there are 2 ends of the ovule, the chalazal end and the micropylar end. Micropylar end is the end where the integuments, that is the layers covering the ovule, have some opening. This is the opening which is used by the ovule usually to get inside the embryo sac. So there are 2 ends, chalazal end and the micropylar end. Inside the integuments, there is embryo sac. This embryo sac consists of nucellus. Nucellus is diploid. It is made up of diploid cells which are meant for nourishment of the embryo sac. And inside the nucellus, this is the place where your ovule is going to ultimately form the female gamete. Let us understand how exactly this particular structure inside the embryo sac, that is shown over here, is formed. So here is the entire process.
Here you will see in part A of the diagram, this is the embryo sac where there is a primary mother cell. This primary mother cell undergoes meiosis and produces 4 haploid megaspores. Can you see in diagram C, there are 4 haploid megaspores. Now there, out of these 4 megaspores, 3 perish and only 1 survives, which is the functional megaspore. This is where it differs from microsporogenesis, where all the 4 microspores survive and form pollens. Here only 1 megaspore survives and forms egg cell. Now we'll continue with the single surviving functional megaspore. This megaspore contains a haploid nucleus. This haploid nucleus first undergoes first mitotic division, thereby forming 2 nuclei, then another mitotic division forming 4 nuclei, then another mitotic division forming 8 nuclei. Now it is a single cell containing 8 nuclei. Now these nuclei move to different edges of the cell. So in the next diagram, that is the H diagram, you can see 3 of them are there towards the chalazal end, and 3 are there towards the micropylar end, and 2 are there in the middle. The 2 middle ones are polar nuclei. The 3 towards the chalazal end are called antipodal cells, and the 3 at the micropylar end, 1 is the egg cell and 2 are synergids. Together 3 of them are called egg apparatus. Now this particular structure is right now containing 1 cell with 8 nuclei. Now this 8 nuclei are ultimately going to form cell membrane around them and thus forming 7 cells. 2 polar nuclei are going to remain as it is, whereas antipodal cells develop a cell membrane around them that makes 3 cells here. Synergids and egg cell also may have a cell membrane around them forming 3 cells. So that is 3 plus 3, 6 cells. And the 7th cell is the cell containing the entire cytoplasm along with 2 polar nuclei. So what you have here is the stage where there are 8 nuclei and 7 cells.
So we have just now learned how the female gamete is formed. Now we are going to understand what happens after male and female gametes have been fully matured. The next step is fertilization of the male and female gamete. But as we know that for fertilization, both the kinds of gametes need to meet. And for that, the process seen in the plants is pollination. That is the movement of the pollen from the male reproductive part to the female reproductive part, that is the stigma. Pollination is brought about by a variety of agents, which we are going to study in the next part of this chapter. But pollination itself is of 2 kinds. In earlier lower classes, you have learned that there are 2 kinds of pollination, cross-pollination and self-pollination. But in terms of the botany or the botanical aspect, it can be classified into 3 forms. Autogamy. Autogamy is when the pollen of the same flower lands on the stigma of the same flower. That is called autogamy. Okay. The second kind is, you may or may not require any pollinators for this. The second kind is gitonogamy, where the pollen of one flower lands on the stigma of another flower. That is the other flower, but both the flowers are belonging to the same plant. So essentially it is like the autogamy. So apparently in terms of the process, it is cross-fertilization or cross-pollination, where there are 2 flowers involved. It may involve pollinators also, but genetically it is autogamy only, because it is the same plant of which the gametes are fused. The third kind is xenogamy, which is the true cross-pollination, where the anther of one plant lands on the stigma of another plant's flower. So the plant is also different. Therefore, the genetic material is also different, and therefore it is genetically proper cross-pollination or cross-fertilization. We are going to understand in the next slide that what are the variety of pollinators that are available and that carry out all these kind of pollinations. So there are a huge number of pollinators. This is one way in which animals contribute to the life cycle of the plants. We know that plants contribute in many, many ways to why animals are able to survive. But pollination is one crucial aspect where animals are useful for plants. So in the coming video, we are going to see some very interesting and ways of how different animals like the bats and the birds and the insects act like pollinators. So in the video you just saw a variety of pollinators. So those are all living pollinators, that is the biotic pollinators. Apart from biotic pollinators, there are also abiotic pollinators. So when we look at biotic pollinators, you could see how they were, you know, at one point of time even vying or fighting for each other, fighting to each other to get the nectars, to get the pollens. So in case of the flowers which are pollinated by the insects, birds or bats, these flowers need to offer something in return for pollination. So what do they offer? Either they offer their nectar or the pollens, which are a source of nutrition, or at times they also offer the site for egg laying. In many interesting examples, as we learn later in the chapters, that many insects, they lay their eggs inside the ovary of the flower, thereby offering the plants a reason to come closer to the flower and in turn carry out pollination. So the flowers which are offering these rewards, so-called rewards to the flower, to the pollinators, these plants, these flowers rather, are good looking. That means they are bright to attract pollinators. They are also rich with nectar. They are also fragrant. So just by looking at the flower, if you look at it close enough, you will be able to find out whether it is pollinated by any of the biotic factors or it is pollinated by the abiotic factors. So flowers pollinated by insects, birds, bats, etc. are fragrant, colorful, and they offer some sort of reward. Whereas the flowers which are pollinated by either water or wind do not have any fragrance. Some of them, completely bland, and they also lack nectar. But what do they have? They have got long filaments, that is the anthers are exposed outside, so that wind or water, whatever the case may be, can easily take away the pollens. Here the pollens are also very light. In case of the wind pollinated flowers, the pollens are very small and light. In case of insect pollinated pollens, the pollens are sticky, so that they can stick to the surface of these organisms. In case of water, the pollens, in case of submerged plants, the pollens can be long and ribbon-like, so that they can easily float with the water currents. The flowers which are wind pollinated also usually do not have any colored petals. So they can be very, drab looking, dull looking. And they are usually born in inflorescence. That means a huge number of flowers are born together. So this is the way we can differentiate between the flowers which are either pollinated by wind or water, or they are pollinated by insects. Now we are going to see a small video about different kind of flowers which are pollinated by water, because water pollination can be of different variety. So let us see that video.
Most of the flowers in the garden are either entomophilous, that is insects help in pollination, or they are anemophilous, that is wind helps in pollination. But what about plants like these that are present on the water? How do these plants get pollinated? Lotus, which remains partially submerged in water and most of it remains above water, can get pollinated by insects. But what about plants like tape seagrass? They remain completely submerged underwater. Wind or insects cannot help in pollination. What then? What transports the male reproductive part to the female reproductive part? Well, in this case, water becomes the transporter. Water transports the male reproductive part or the entire male flower to the female flower. In this case, we see Vallisneria flower. See, this is the male Vallisneria flower which gets transported to the female Vallisneria flower, and that is how pollination takes place in these plants that remain submerged underwater. Such flowers are known as hydrophilous flowers, where hydro means water and philos means affinity. Now you have often seen ponds like these which have not been cleaned for a few days, and you see small spherical structures like these. What are these spherical structures? Well, these spherical structures are nothing but the pollen grains, thus facilitating the fact that water can be a transporter for pollination. Now, how do substances float on the water? Well, if a substance is less denser than water, then it can float. Now, we've studied in physics that density is mass per unit volume, which means mass that is spread across a volume. Now, can you tell me, how does a small iron nail sink in water, but a huge iron ship, which is thousands of times the mass of this iron pin, floats on the water? Well, this is because the mass of the iron pin is concentrated across a smaller volume, whereas the mass of this huge ship is spread across a wider volume. Thus, the density becomes lesser than water, while the density of the pin becomes more than that of water, and hence it sinks. For pollen grains to float on water, it needs to have a smaller mass for a fixed volume, or if a mass is fixed, then the volume needs to grow bigger. So, for pollen grains to float on water, they have modified shape. They either become very lightweight, or they change their volume, they increase their volume so that they can float on water and can bring about pollination.
So now let us talk about the two kinds of flowers which are seen in certain plants. Most of the flowers that you see around are open. Open means that the anthers and all the floral parts, the whorls, are easily visible. They are exposed to the environment. And they should be open, because how else will the pollen move out or the pollinators move in? So such flowers are open flowers. They are called chasmogamous flower. But in certain flowers or in certain plants, there are some other kinds of flowers also seen, which are called cleistogamous flowers. These flowers are closed. That means they never open. Even when they are fully mature, the petals remain closed. So what is the advantage? Why should such flowers be there? The advantage is that if the flower is closed, then the pollen of the same flower is going to land on the stigma of the same flower. So it ensures pollination. Whereas if the flower is open, so there are some chances, even though less, but the chances are there that the stigma may not get any good. So these flowers have got a surety that the pollination will happen, and therefore fertilization will happen. So they have got assured seed sex. That means seed is going to be formed in these flowers. Whereas the chasmogamous flowers, because they are open, so they may or may not form seeds. But the advantage is that because the pollens are coming from different flowers, different plants, therefore the variations are going to be many, many more. So these two kinds of flowers have their own advantages and disadvantages. So some plants bear both the flowers.
The first one is the cleistogamous flower. You can see it's closed. The second one is chasmogamous. You can see the flowers are open. And the third picture shows you both the kinds of flowers present in the same plant.
So we learned that there are two kinds of flowers, closed and open, and as we recall, the open flowers are going to get more genetic variability. So therefore, plants are designed in such a manner, many flowers are specially designed in such a manner that there are more and more chances of fertilization between the flowers of different plants. This is called outbreeding, and the plants have devised various ways by which outbreeding is ensured. So those ways are called outbreeding devices. So outbreeding devices means the devices which will ensure that the self-fertilization or self-pollination is not preferred. The outbreeding is preferred. And why will it be preferred? So that the plant will get more genetic variability and the chances of survival are more. We are going to learn about the variety of outbreeding devices through this video.